This mass is being offered for the soul of Manello Nezo by Kirby Nezo. Thanksgiving, prayer and blessings for Rachel Antet, birthday by Rachel Antet. Presiding is Father Mehta. Please stand.
To you I lift up my soul, O my God. In you I have trusted. Let me not be put to shame, nor let my enemies exult over me. And let none who hope in you be put to shame. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
In the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit, be with you all.
Amen.
My dear friends, we thank God for the gift of this day, the first Sunday in the season of Advent. We thank God for His love and for His mercies, and we pray that He journeys with us as we begin this holy season. In our Mass this morning, the Eternal Lord has it for the Holy Souls in Purgatory. Elizabeth is also praying in a special way for the happy repose and God's blessing on Luigi and Luigi. Gary Mazzo offers this also for the happy report of Marcelo Mazzo. Rachel Arte is also thanking God and praying for her birthday. My dear friends, let us now acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mystery.
You said.
righteous deeds at his coming, so that gathered at his right hand, they may be worthy to possess the heavenly kingdom. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, his Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen. A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. You, O Lord, are our Father. Our Redeemer from of old is your name. Why, O Lord, do you make us stray from your ways and harden our heart so that we do not fear you? Turn back for the sake of your servants, for the sake of the tribes that are your heritage. Oh, that you would tear open the heavens and come down, so that the mountains would quake at your presence. Then you did awesome deeds that we did not expect. You came down, the mountains quaked at your presence. From ages past, no one has heard, no ear has perceived, no eye has seen any God besides you, who works for those who wait for him. You meet those who gladly do right, those who remember you in your way. But you were angry, and we sinned. Because you hid yourself, we transgressed. We have all become like one who is unclean, and all our righteous deeds are like a filthy cloth. We all fade like a leaf, and our iniquities, like the wind, take us away. There is no one who calls on your name or attempts to take hold of you, for you have hidden your face from us and have delivered us into the hand of our iniquity. Yet, O Lord, you are our Father, we are the clay, and you are our potter. We are all the work of your hand. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Responsorial Psalm, restore us, O God, and let your face shine, that we may be saved.
Restore us, O God, let your face shine, and that we may be saved.
Keep ear, O Shepherd of Israel, you who are enthroned upon the cherubim, say, shine forth, stir up your might, and come to save us. Restore us, O God, let your face shine, turn again, O God of hosts. Look down from heaven and see. Have regard for this wine, the stock that your right hand has planted. Restore us, O God, let your face shine and be saved. But let your hand be upon the man at your right, the Son of Man you have made strong for yourself. Then we will never turn back from you. Give us light, and we will call on your name.
Restore us, O God, let your face shine, and we may be saved.
A reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I give thanks to my God always for you, because of the grace of God that has been given you in Christ Jesus, for in every way you have been enriched in him, in speech and knowledge of every kind. Just as the testimony of Christ has been strengthened among you, so that you are not lacking in any spiritual gift, as you wait for the revealing of our Lord Jesus Christ, he will also strengthen you to the end, so that you may be blameless on the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is faithful. By him you were called into fellowship with his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Aleluya, aleluya, aleluya.
keep alert, for you do not know when the time will come. It is like a man going on a journey. When he leaves home, then puts his slaves in charge, each with a particular task, and commands the doorkeeper to be on the watch. Therefore, keep awake, for you do not know when the master of the house will come, in the evening, or at midnight, or at cockcrow, or at dawn. Or else, he may find you asleep when he comes suddenly. And what I say to you, I say to all, keep awake. The Gospel of the Lord. My dear friends, I once more welcome all of you to this morning celebration, the first Sunday of Advent, the beginning of the Church's new year, and of course a season of expectation. That is why you will notice the Church has come back again to a time that we are called upon to reflect a little bit more, to have a bit more introspection, to go into ourselves a bit more, a season that we put on this purple vestment, a time to ask ourselves questions about our readiness to welcome the Son of God when he comes in our midst, in our lives. In our reading today, my dear friends, especially from the Gospel, Christ said, "Beware and keep alert, for you do not know when the time will come." It is calling on us, my dear friends, for readiness to prepare ourselves in all the ways that we can to be ready. Because the truth is, someday, sometime, some way, somehow, I've mentioned before that, of course, God transcends space and time. God is above time. There is no 1 a.m., 2 a.m., or 3 a.m. in his domain. But he gave us time to help us plan and arrange ourselves, arrange our lives. In our first reading today, from the prophecy of Isaiah, it was talking about our total dependence on God, our mistakes, and our coming back to Him, asking for His assistance, for His help, to mold, to remake us. And in the last verse that we read, the prophet said, "Yet, O Lord, you are our Father. We are the clay. And you are our potter. We are all the work of your hand." We are the clay, and you are our potter. We are all the work of your hand. Many of you have sung, not many might have seen. We are pots, clay pots. Many may not have seen it. But back in the village, a good number of times before, gradually, we started having containers. It is the clay pot that we use to store things, to store even water. But it's so fragile that when you give it something, it breaks to pieces. So to prepare it and to mold it, even some houses we are built with clay. So it resonates when the prophet is telling God, "We are the clay and you are the potter." Because you see the potter as he molds the pots, or many of the earthenware vessels that mold with that clay. You will see it sometimes after a while, it starts afresh, or all the designs and all that. When you watch it, see how the potter does it, and when you listen to what the prophet is saying, you will understand what exactly the prophet was trying to say. That we are simply clay in the hands of God, who is the potter. Like the Psalm 23 that we recited the other Sunday, "The Lord is my shepherd," simply means that we have to abandon ourselves to the care of the shepherd. Just like the clay is simply a tool in the hands of the potter to be molded in whichever way the potter wants. That is exactly the way, my dear friends,
we have to align ourselves, allow ourselves to be clay in the hands of God, who is the potter. And today Christ is asking us, those of us who accepted that we are that clay, what the potter wants of us is to be ready, to prepare ourselves. We have always celebrated this great solemnity. But in this terrible time, with lots of things, lots of incidents, lots of that, there was a friend called a few days ago and was telling me that she had COVID and that she is still on it. She said, please tell whoever in all of our things that this thing is not true, tell them that it is true. She is not out of the woods yet, still fighting and battling with her life. And this season and this whole period and life now totally means something different to her. She's now seeing life in a very different way. She feels like if there is a way she can even address us to tell us, listen, this is real. She said, I've written my will, I've done everything. I even wrote a letter to my boy, apologizing to him. I'm sorry that I got this in case I don't make it. It was a great opportunity for her for a wonderful introspection. And it helps us, my dear friends, not just because of the tragedy, but for us to remind ourselves that time, our time is limited here on earth. As we prepare ourselves for this great solemnity, this is, we have already lighted the first candle. Before you know it, we'll light the second one, the third. What do you prepare yourself to achieve before we light the second candle? What virtues are you ready to imbibe before them? In our opening prayers, we ask God, grant your faithful, we pray, Almighty God, the resolve to run forth to meet your Christ with righteous deeds. Grant us the resolve to run forth to meet your Christ with righteous deeds. What righteousness are you prepared to imbibe before we light the second candle? My dear friends, demands of us sitting back to reflect, to ask ourselves this pertinent question, to strive within ourselves, to meet the honor. It might be to forgive someone who may have offended you. It might be to let go of the anger and resentment that you have already inside of you. It might be to love more. It might be to be more charitable with the gifts that God has given you. To be more charitable with your time and talent. It might be to be more patient, maybe with your children, maybe with your parents, maybe with your husband, maybe with your wife. Sometimes they drive you nuts. But there is this saying in my place that whatever you call your dog, whatever you name your dog, it answers. Whatever name you give your dog is what it answers. And there is one thing, my dear friends. Whatever you say will annoy you, will annoy you. There are certain things that may not change. The best that we can do is to change ourselves, not to change your husband, not to change your wife, not to change your children, not to change your parents. The best that we can do is to work on ourselves to change our attitude towards things. There is a particular type of nickname or a derogatory name that someone called me somewhere. And I kind of took that word, started looking at it, asking myself, why must this offend me? And why must I accepted it. And I was liberated. If I am called out again, it doesn't offend me again because I come to terms with that reality. But there are times we don't come to terms with certain things, and therefore we become slaves to those things. You allow yourself, it's like someone handing a remote control. Press play, it plays. You press stop, it stops. You press rewind, it goes back. There are certain ways we take certain things. It's like handing someone a remote control to be manipulating you. You totally collected the entire authority of happiness and gave it to someone to play with, to manipulate you, to determine when you are happy or unhappy. Sometimes they want to make you talk. They want to make you really, really upset, to react. And I learned how to accept those things and to keep quiet when I was expected to react. I had to work on myself a great deal. Ordinarily, I wasn't like that. My temperament wasn't like that. I shoot straight. But at some point, I kind of said to myself, life is not like this. Or else you'll continue to be in pains. And I had to make an effort myself to save me, not to save another person. To save me. It's a conscious decision that you have to make. And when we do this, my dear friends, who will believe? Who will find happiness again? There are certain things that we have to learn, not necessarily to control, but to accept certain things that we cannot change. If we want to change the world, it is an impossible task. But if we want to change ourselves, it is very possible. It can happen. That can be true. It is in this same way, my dear friends, that we will imbibe this righteousness that we are asking God to help us avail ourselves of it so that we will encounter Christ with those righteousness. It might be difficult. It might seem impossible. There was this book I read sometime by Anthony de Mello, an Indian. He called it The Prayer of the Frog. How one can sometimes be in perfect peace and quiet amongst various types of noise and distraction. It's like sometimes when kids come to mass and they run around, they make noise. You know, there was a time when I left the seminary early, the time I was really ordained, because of the way I was in the seminary for 17 years. In the church is perfectly, everything is perfect. The way it should be. But life out there is not like that. Kids will come to church. Kids will make noise. They will distract you. And that all said, it was so upsetting. But when I remember that book, because I read it while I was in the seminary, I read it again, and about so many other stories. I find out that that noise those children make, it contributes to the symphony of the beautiful prayers that we offer to God. God loves them. God loves those things that they are, in as much as they sometimes upset us, or they are making us, they are distracting us. But the beauty of it before God is like when you hear some of us pray. Back at home, the area where I worked was mostly my people. I hear everything they are saying. I know all the prayers they are saying. But when I moved to other places, or for instance, when I was in St. Patrick's Basilica downtown, the during confessions, so many people from so many areas, and after confession, you should ask that person to say the act of contrition. Some say it in another. And that was, it will be like getting drunk. We don't even understand. But God understands that it's beautiful. Some say it in Chinese, some in Spanish, some in French. They are not making noise, in as much as it will sound like noise in your own ears. But the prayer is being said to God, not to you. That is the beauty. So, if you want that to sound like noise or to annoy you, you see that you are the person that has the problem, not the person saying the prayers, not to God who is listening to the prayers. That, my dear friends, is life. The Bible was talking here about the clay and the potter. Many of our kids, many who are born here, they don't understand what that means. Christ was talking about when the owner of the house might come. It might be in the evening or midnight or at cockcrow or at dawn. Many don't have an idea what cockcrow means. But those of us who are born in the village, we know what it means. Because around 5:30 a.m., the cock will crow. That is the alarm clock that we use there. And the cock, you don't go and tell the cock to crow. It will do it at that time. After about 30 minutes again, it will crow again before there is now daylight. So, some of us who are born in the village understand it. Many kids here have not even seen the light kit before. They see it in the video. The rest that they see is in the shops, food business, to go and get them to cook. They have no idea how it works around, nothing. But for some of us who know this, it resonates. It makes even the family. Why am I saying this, my dear friends? We are asking God to help us. Run forth to meet Christ with righteousness. The time to start is now. Pick one area of your life, one thing that really makes you upset, and look at it. Think about it. Tinker with that. Pray about that. You will be surprised at how you will get the kind of healing. And that thing that upsets you will no longer be upsetting you. It might be what someone is a lot. Our lives are all different. Work on yourself. Find one particular area that you're struggling with. Keep it and address it. Look at it. Go to God before it. And you will find out that before 1 week runs out, you have made a great progress. Let us continue to pray, my dear friends, that this holy season will immensely affect and impact our lives positively. Let us live the and work and strive as if this will be our last Christmas. When we make the best of it, God will continue to bless and draw us closer to Himself. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. May we stand to profess our faith. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through Him all things are made, for us again and for our salvation. He came down from heaven. By the Holy Spirit was the incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. By our Savior was crucified on the cross of Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and His kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is the God and glorified, who has spoken to the apostles. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church, and I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead, and
life and free from avoidance issues, we pray to the Lord.
For Lord, hear our
prayers. For world peace, that the leaders of the nations will stay awake in the face of so much human suffering caused by the pandemic, resist the temptation to be absorbed in self-interest, and work together for the common good of all. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
For greater attentiveness, that our minds and hearts may be focused upon the tasks we do, the people we love, and the God whom we serve today. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
For all who are awaiting the birth of a child, and for all who must wait, that God will strengthen and comfort all who are waiting with the sick, those who are awaiting a diagnosis, those separated from loved ones, and those who are held unjustly. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
For each of us, and for patience during this Advent season, that we may discover God's word in every sound that touches our ears, God's touch in every human embrace, and God's love in every gesture of self-sacrifice among us. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all of us suffering from the coronavirus and other illness, that God will heal the sick, give strength to those who care for them, and guide all who are working on vaccines. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all those who have died, that they may be granted the peace of God's heavenly kingdom. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
Let us pray. Lord, you are our Father. We are the clay, you are the potter. We are all the work of your hands. Fashion in us the image of your Son Jesus, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Promise in which now we live.
And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of pure glory, as without end we acclaim.
Blessed apostles and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be
who edged the general line, and we praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever.
Desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot at this moment receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you were already there, and unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen.
Thank you. Let us pray.
May these mysteries, O Lord, in which we have participated, profit us, we pray. For even now, as we walk amid passing things, you teach us by them to love the things of heaven and hold fast to what endures, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord.